Mark is, I'm not sure if you want to introduce yourself.
Yeah. I work in sales in Axon. And today, and probably you've heard about this device already, maybe you've seen it. This is what we introduce here is our new neural device. This is a not working device. It's just to show you how it looks, what the architecture is. But I can assure you it's working and we are shipping at the moment. So the product was launched at IBC last year. We had a few delays due to several reasons. But now the product is ready for shipping. I think Jean-Pierre, he will explain you in more detail what Neuron is about.
So who heard about Neuron? That's a couple. Yeah. Okay. So yeah, you just heard about this. So you can check if I'm telling the right things now. So what is Neuron? We call it a network attached processor, a NAP. Why a network attached processor? Today, the whole broadcast infrastructures are going to change from SDI, the coax connections, to IP, off-the-shelf switches, and that kind of stuff. And this processor is being made to connect to these switches and work as gateway functionality, but it's really designed from the bottom up as an IP product. What's the market? 24/7, like our Synapse gear we had before, so our infrastructure modules, and it needs to run 24/7, of course. What we would like to do is we would like to have more density within the processing units itself. Before, we needed racks of processing units to do a couple of conversions in the broadcast facilities, and now we can condense everything to a very small form factor. That's also an aim of Neuron. And therefore, if we can condense the functionality within the unit, then we also have less power consumption. Everything needs to be more green, so we can go that way too with this design. Another thing is that because we're going to IP, we also would like to put our equipment in data centers. This unit, and I will show you later on, this unit is also capable to be put in a data center. Power supply can be changed the other way around. The connections will then be at the front side instead of the back side. So that's an easier way to connect it in a data center. So the platform itself, it's IP-based, like I explained. It will have an option board to connect it to legacy equipment out there, so SDI equipment. Still an option for that. It has a redundant Ethernet connection. So I will show you. Maybe you can turn it around. I'm not sure if you all can see it.
Actually, for your idea, this unit contains two Neuron processors. So it's a one IU frame, and it has two slots. And each slot contains one Neuron processing unit. And here on the front side, you see the power supplies.
Yeah, I will explain it later on. So the connectivity is 2 times 100 gig, 4 times 25 gig, which you can use in 50 gig redundant or 100 gig redundant. It has some Ethernet connections. So one is for control, GPI, for audio, IP audio, so like AES, 67 or Dante. That all can be connected through normal RJ45 connectors. The rest is through fiber, like most of the equipment now is connected nowadays. You also already explained a little bit about the processing units. In this one, we've got a couple of processing units which are actually capable of handling 32 channels of 3G processing, like frame syncing, up-down cross conversion, embedding, de-embedding, you name it, all these functions which we needed before in the broadcast environment. So in one unit, we can hold 64 times processing for 3G channels, or what is it, 16 times UHD, or a combination between the two. So in total, every board will have 40 connectors, 40 SDI connectors, so the SDI connection part, which is you see here. It will be 8 12G inputs, dedicated inputs, 8 12G dedicated outputs, and 24 bidirectional 3G connectors. So you can use them input as output. And this unit, this is the hardware, but it will be capable of handling 2022-6, AES67, 2110, all the standards out there which are there or will be there in the future. Okay, where is this unit, where can this unit be used? If you look at this drawing, you can see a typical network setup. A spine leaf connection, where at the leaf all endpoints, end nodes will be connected, and where the spine can be connected to a really IP processing part itself. So we can use it as a pure IP processor without the SDI options. Then we've got the 100 gig redundant, or you can use it as a gateway, which it actually is showing over there. So you can use it as IP in, IP out. SDI in, SDI out, and the conversion between the two. This unit is capable of handling 2022-6 at the same time as 2110. Different standards can be converted both ways. And what's our end goal with this unit? At the moment is being delivered as a gateway function, so the bridging between the SDI, UHD, 2022-6 or 2110, the other way around. And it's a fixed functionality, but in the near future we will go to virtual processing parts. So now we've got fixed functionality, and then you as a customer will be, you have the possibility to put in flexible functionality. So maybe a part will be a multi-viewer later on, a part you need for gateway functionality, maybe you need some color correction, HDR conversion. And you will be able to put it in yourself later on. So why is this processing box, the NAP, needed? Years ago, there were big matrices. And within these matrices or routers, you had the switch fabric from SDI to SDI. And they also put multi-viewing in, frame syncing, and all the processing was put in these matrices. If we are going to the off-the-shelf switches, you don't have this functionality anymore. Cisco is not building the processing inside their switches. It's the same in account for Arista Extreme. So only the switch fabric is there, so you still need the processing part, and there comes there you need Neuron, actually. If you take a look at the big matrices, the cost of a 2,000 square router, that's really, it's not existing now, it's 1,024 more or less, or 1,162. But if you calculate the price of a normal switch, it's much cheaper. So if we can use off-the-shelf switches, the whole infrastructure should be cheaper. The cabling should be cheaper. I said should be cheaper because we're in a transition, and the 100 gig fibers are more costly than the 10 gig fibers or even a coax. But it's changing really rapidly. I spoke to a vendor of these QSFPs, the 100 gigs, and a year ago they were about 1,100 euros, and now it's $170. So the price erosion is a lot with these devices. So it will be cheaper fairly quickly. So if we take everything out of the switches again, this is the these are the things you can process within a broadcast facility. So what we already do is IP to baseband, the other way around. up-down cross-conversion, that's something we do already, synchronization, embedding, de-embedding, and we will add all these functions which are here into Neuron. So multi-viewing, we already are in discussion with NDP about a nice functionality in this multi-viewer. We're changing the functionality we've put on the roadmap already. All the teams are working on that as we speak. We will add a lot of functionality within this gateway. So at the moment we've got up-down cross-conversion, embedding, de-embedding, but the color space conversion will also be implemented, was a request. But also Dolby processing. If you take a look at this unit, you see big coolers. We've got an FPGA, which is doing all the parallel processing, which you actually need for a lot of parallel SDI connections, high bandwidth. But we also have the smart module, which is actually a PC on a small board. We are going to use that for the Dolby encoding and decoding, or loudness control. Nowadays, all the manufacturers of these kind of algorithms have changed their functionality from a DSP to x86 processors. So that's also functions we can do on that board, as well as recording later on. So we have the option to put M2 SATA, like what you have in the laptops, the memories in the laptops. We also can put them two on board. So we can also use that for recording later on. So this platform is really, I think, future-proof for the next 10 years. The frame. Mark already explained a little bit about the frame itself. So it's a one-rack unit frame with a redundant power supply, two times a 500 watts power supply, which can actually feed, one power supply can feed two boards. It's about 200 watts a board. If you compare it to the SVR18 we had before, it was a 500 watts power supply for 18 slots, 18 cards. With one of these boards, let's say 32 channels of 3G processing, we needed, let's say, a full SVR18 frame for one and a half SVR18 frame to process the same amount we can do in one rack unit here. So the density is half a rack unit with, in comparison with four rack units before. So two port positions, Mark already explained that. Now we've got two processing boards in one unit. Later on we also will have an audio board. The audio board will be able to convert any legacy standards out there to IP and from IP. So analog, digital, Dante, AES67, all these things back and forth, like the main board will do. The cooling, and that's in this version, this is the normal broadcast version, it will go from front to back. If you're going to change that to a data center module, then this part will be exchanged to the front and the front to the back, and then the direction of the power supplies also will be changed. Like I explained, it's designed from the bottom up as an IP product, not an SDI, and the SDI has been added to the product, so that's a big advantage. So this is the frame. We already see that, saw that. Just to give you a quick explanation, you can see it over there too, but the 2x100 gig, 4x25 gig, this is something I didn't explain yet. The unit is capable of outputting a bi-level and tri-level sync. It can be generated from PTP, but it also can be used as a reference input. So I can connect the input here. This is a loop and a second input. So if you have 50 and 60 hertz at the same time in the same unit, which could be possible because you have so many channels running within your system, then you're also able to connect to different references to the unit. This is just a sum up of all I/O we have on the unit. A good thing is that the unit also is capable of handling a single wire 12G. So if there is equipment out there which can do four quadrants or single wire. This unit also can cope with that. Yeah, this is a spoiler already because I've got the unit here. Yeah, this is something I explained already. So the expansion slots we have, and now I've got the module here. Expansion slots for the M2 SATA are located here for a Denta module on this place, and the Dolby processing can be done on this PC module. If there are any questions, you just can ask. So, you had the question just before we started. What's deliverable right now? So we started having the deliveries just before NAB. So the units are being shipped as we speak. The frames are there, the power supplies are there, the main boards are there. And what's the functionality on this unit? So we can use the 100 gig QSFPs. It's 2022-6 as we speak. We've got 16 processing channels that will be up to 32 processing channels in a couple of weeks. It's working for 50 hertz at the moment. So UHD 4 quadrant, 1080p, 1080i and 720p. So what are you using here?
1080i.
1080i, okay. It locks to P2P and Blackburst. It will do the embedding and de-embedding and the automatic tracking delay if you're using the frame syncs. And the cross-down conversion is working. And the I/O option board, which is over there, is also working. This is the release we're shipping right now. The next release, and that's actually in test already, that's the 2110 release. So it has already been built. The only thing is that, yeah, it needs to be tested. And if you need to test 32 channels, all the standards, it will take a while. So that's the team is busy with that at the moment. It will be changed from 50 also to 60 hertz. And actually, which is not on this slide, the audio shuffler is also already in. So it's a 512 by 512 mono shuffler, and we can shuffle from AES or 2110 30 or the embedded audio to the other ways.
2110-31, what is that?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think it's on the roadmap. Oh, already on the slides. That will be Q2. The teams are working on that already. I'm not sure where they are at right now. So the audio shuffle, that's already in the release of April. These are the things we're going to change. So the 12G, the 2SI, GPIs, tri-level. Let's see.
Just for your information, all that we are going to change is software.
Yeah.
Right. So the hardware is finished, will not change anymore. So we currently work on the software of the device.
Yeah.
Which means that if you buy a device today, you can upgrade it. So if new releases become available, you can upgrade it software-wise.
So you also would like to have 2022-7, I guess? Yeah, okay. That will be Q3 probably, but we're discussing this. It depends on the amount of people who need this, that we're going to change the priorities for that. I know the teams are researching this already to implement this. Also with ISO 5, they're working on that already. I'm not sure where they come up with, so that's something we can share later on. Let's see. Okay, this is a little bit difficult to see or not. So this is in the end what we try to build in the NPG 3200. Yeah, I can't read it, even with glasses. Yeah. I can point a lot, but so the thing is, at the left side you see the SDI IO, so inputs, outputs. It's 8 in fixed, 8 in out, and depending on the direction you can change the 24 connectors. Then you see the test pattern generators, And in the middle, you see all the processing functionality. Actually, you see 8 parts. 1, 2, 3, 2, 8. And every path is divided in 4 3G channels. So what can we do with that? We can use it as a separate channel, and really separate. So this could be 50, this could be 60, 50, 60, different standards. Or we can, in case of UHD, we can group these paths together. Then it will work in 4 quadrants. In case it will be a single wire, then we can change the functionality to a single wire, but this whole path will be condensed to 1 wire, if you like. And it will be connected to one of these 8 physical inputs. And of course, at the end, at one of these physical outputs, or IP, depending on what you need at the output. I really can't read it, so it's really difficult. But at the left side, we've got the de-embedding parts and the embedder parts, which are actually in right now. And I can show you what is in right now. So the embedders, de-embedders, down conversion, the combiner for UHD is already in, and then the audio delay and gain is in. 110 test generator is in, and we're using the 100 gig connection actually as 25 gig connections at the moment. That's it for now. The April release will have more functionality in the conversion part, so we will have the up conversion, so to 4K implemented, and down conversion from 4K. The big audio shuffle from 512x512 mono channels will also be implemented, so we can take audio from the IP part or the SDI part, which is de-embedded, and we can output it to IP or embed it again in the SDI channels or 2022-6 channels. The next step will be, and that will be June, we will have 16 channels additional. So we can convert 32 channels, so 16 with processing, 16 without processing, to IP and back and forth. And then we expect to have all the 32 channels fully functional at the summer. So that's still a fair amount of work. The 100 gigs are working. Together with the 25 gigs. That's actually a small change as we use the 25 gig max already as we speak. I would say that my colleague, who is over there, well, he can show you the GUI later on. So we have a working GUI over there. So I will skip that part. Let's see. Then we've got a couple of products which are which we also start working on very soon, and one of that is the firewall. That's a request we got a lot of times. So if one, because we're connected to IP from the outside to a facility, we also would like to have a galvanic a disconnection over there, and also these units can be used over there, so you won't have processing in the system itself, but it will be 100 gig coming in, or 2x25, and the 100 gig out, and there will be a disconnection, if you like, in this unit. That's a product we're going to introduce probably before the end of the year. And then one of the most important parts, and that's actually this one. It's really preliminary. We currently are working on the multiviewer as we speak, also in the same unit. So it will be a change only of software, and it will be a distributed multiviewer. So meaning one processing board will be an output stage, which can combine a lot of inputs over there to multiple heads, and you will have the option for an 8K head, so 8K 60 hertz, 4x4K on 60 hertz, 50-60, or 60x3G, so 16 heads of 3G within this unit. And then we have an input stage which will scale all the SDIs or the IPs already on the network to a specific size which can be combined in the combiner stage. But this is really preliminary. The specifications are there already, but and this is something I explained in the beginning already. The end goal for Neuron is actually to have a virtual system. So you will have your hardware, and for every different thing you need to do, you can change the processing parts. We saw the 8 processing parts before. The idea is to exchange the processing part for different functionality. So maybe it will be a UHD channel, or you can remove 2 UHD parts for a small multi-viewing module. And that's something that will be implemented in the end. So first we will come out with fixed products, like a gateway, like a multi-viewer, like a firewall. And then later on we will have mixed functionality available. Yeah, and how this will look like, this is a big blob. So all these, and that's what I was explaining, so we've got all the processing parts, which actually is the 4 channels, 4-channel processing part, can be exchanged for other functionality. Yeah, that's something we will start working on, I guess, the halfway this year. Oh. Just to give you a little heads up of the audio board, I just explained that we also will have an audio board later on. And that will, yeah, it's really difficult to read. But you will have the options to put I.O. boards on this board. So it will be a main board where you have a couple of sleeves, we call it. And on these sleeves, you can put analog inputs, analog outputs, or digital, or a combination. You will have the option to put 2 Denta modules in the system to do Dolby processing, loudness control, and that all will be, yeah, this is the I.O., the option boards, and you will have a big shuffler in the middle where you can connect anything to anything, so your analog part to IP or whatever you wish to do. Yeah, this board will be there, I guess, just before IBC.
But that's a physically different board. Yeah. In this.
It will be a full board like the other one. It's a different processing board, so with a less large FPGA. But more functionality on that. So on the main board for the video, we have the option for 1 Denta module. Mm-hmm. On the other one, we have 2. We'll have more options for the conversion for analog to digital and that kind of stuff, which we don't have on the main processing module. Mm-hmm. So if you take a look at the main processing module here, there's no analog or digital audio connections anyway. Yeah, the only thing is AES over IP. Mm-hmm. Mainly everything is converting to that, so that will be the future. But in the meantime, there's still a lot of legacy equipment which need to be connected. So that's why we came up with an audio board like that. So we have a couple of analog I.O. AES67, 256 channels, and you can optionally put different modules on, like the SMARC module or the Denta module, to give you access to more functionality. And this is a quick overview of the back panel for the module. Also MADI connectors here on coax, but also on fiber. Do you still think you need this within the facilities?
Always need some analog audio, but
small. Yeah, so and that's all also in different places. So that's not a condensed place where you use all the analog audio. It will be around the facilities. Yeah, okay.
Today it's more mainly cabled into a machine room rec room anyway, most of it.
Yeah, this is something I will skip. So, any questions?
Did you explain about the 100 gig data bus between the boards inside?
That's a good one. The boards itself, they have a 100 gig connection to the outside world. They can work as a separate board, both sides actually. In case we ever would need any processing more than we can fit on one module, which is a lot at the moment, but maybe we could expand functionality, then there's an